Okay, good afternoon, everybody. So glad to have you join us for today's Talk with Doc. Today is going to be a talk that I think is so important for every single family to be able to join in on. We today will be talking on childhood trauma in a pandemic. And I'm honored today to have my dear friend Jolene Filo join us, author, speaker, expert when it comes to trauma and PTSD and kids, and we are going to jump into it. So thanks for joining us, Jolene. Why don't you go ahead and just tell everyone a little bit about you, and then we'll get into things.
Well, thanks for having me back again today. I am actually a former educator. I taught school for 25 years, and I taught everything from kindergarten up through high school level juvenile delinquents, as they were called back in the day, to gifted ed, and third and fourth grade, and country school. So I've had a wide variety of experiences. I am also the parent of a child who had a major birth defect, life-threatening birth defect that required surgery immediately, birth, and several surgeries for the first 7 years of his life, another surgery when he was 15. Other than that, he did very well in all other aspects other than this physical issue. But when he was in middle school and high school, we started seeing some behaviors, and it took us a while to find someone who could diagnose what he was dealing with as post-traumatic stress disorder caused by all that early medical intervention that saved his life. So, you know, I am not throwing shade at medical professionals. They saved our son's life. He wouldn't be here. Right. Had it not been for them. But what we learned, and what has been learned in the years since then — he was born in 1982, we've learned so much more about PTSD and kids caused by a variety of things. So it's an important topic that I'm passionate about educating people regarding.
Absolutely. So again, just wanted to invite our attendees who are watching on Zoom and those who are watching on Facebook, if you get any questions today, as always, we'd love to take those questions. You can put them on Zoom in our Q&A or in the chat, and we'll get those. And anyone watching on Facebook Live, you can put them in the comment section, and I'll be monitoring those there as well, and we'll be happy to take those. So, Jolene, let's just jump right into it. And with one of the big and probably most obvious question, why can an event like a pandemic that we're in right now actually cause trauma for a child? You know, that's just kind of mind-blowing for some people, but it really can.
Well, I think we have to look, as we do with all trauma related to children, we have to look at it from their eyes. So all of a sudden, just like our lives were interrupted when the pandemic hit, and we weren't going to work, the kids were at home, our routines were all shot. That's very disconcerting to everyone, including children, even more so to children, because they are younger, smaller, more vulnerable, and they don't know how to negotiate change the way adults do. They don't have a long enough history to realize that, well, things like this happen, but we can get through them. Things might not be the same on the other side of this event, but we'll get through them, and we'll have learned some things through them that have made us stronger and more resilient and more flexible for the future. Kids don't have that. They also are extremely dependent on adults. And so however they see the adults in their life respond to an event, a global event like a pandemic, that is going to inform their response to it. So if the adults who are caring for them stay calm, stay positive, in front of the kids at least, stay focused, you know, are able to give the love to the children that they need and then receive love back from them, if that's the environment the children are in, they're probably going to handle the pandemic well. But of course, we as adults are going through this same kind of shift and change, and we don't always respond well. So if we become really freaked out or bent out of shape or get irritable or angry or start crying or whatever, our children are more likely to suffer from the ill effects of that and experience trauma in their lives. The other thing is, if we also as adults are obsessing about it, and we are just like constantly watching the news to get the latest report, or constantly online, and it's all we're talking about at meals, and we're worried, is there going to be a vaccine? If we have that attitude and we allow this pandemic to rule our lives as their caregivers, it's going to rule their lives too. And that's why it can be a very disconcerting, traumatic time for children.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And then when on top of that, you know, one of the other things we got to remember is, you know, even just everything going about the pandemic, wearing a mask and, mm-hmm. and all those things, these are all things out of the normal for, right. for a child, and not being at school. And now the whole thing is we're coming up to the school year. Do we go to school? Do we yes. not go to school? And all that. So all of these things play into the effects on trauma with a child and
exactly.
things that we need to be aware of and think through. So let's jump into the next part then with that. What are some behaviors or symptoms then that would actually indicate that someone is struggling with trauma or issues from trauma?
That's a really good question. And I think we have to remember when we're talking about children here, we're talking about children from birth to age 18. That's our definition of children. And so a response from someone who's under the age of 3 is going to be quite different from a teenager's response. So, but there are some things that I think go across the board. One of them would be if the baby, the elementary age child, the preschooler, the adolescent, the almost adult teen, if they are having sleep issues, that can be a really good indicator of trauma. And that could take the form of they have a really hard time falling asleep. They are very adamant and argumentative at bedtime. They just don't want to go to sleep. Or they do go to sleep, but they wake up frequently with nightmares or night terrors, or maybe even sleepwalking, or, you know, any of those things related to sleep issues. That can be an indicator of trauma. A couple others are, I think, especially with older children, and I remember experiencing this myself at the beginning of the pandemic, like when you're trying to figure out what's going on and everything's changing from day to day, just kind of a lack of motivation to do anything. Yeah. Because like, how can I get motivated and make plans to do anything when tomorrow it might all change? So that lack of motivation, if that continues over a long time, you know, after we're kind of getting in the groove and figuring out how to move forward, if your child is still unmotivated when they're normally a motivated person, that would be an indicator, or just a lack of interest in the things that usually they like. So I remember my son had this period in his life when he was like totally into castles. He read every book from the library on castles. This was pre-internet, but he would have been on every internet site about castles. He had all the Lego castle sets, and he could do that for hours, talk about castles, draw them, whatever. But if he had been around now and all of a sudden he didn't care about castles or any of his other interests, that might be a good indicator. Another one would be obsessing about the pandemic. Just like I was talking about adults, if the child is obsessing about it, constantly watching and wanting to watch all the coverage all the time, that can be a difficult. There was a study that came out after 9/11 that found that children who watched the coverage over and over, if you remember, you know, it was 24/7, they would have right. that same shot of the towers coming down. Children who watched excessive amounts of coverage were more likely to develop trauma issues and PTSD going forward. And those who didn't were much less at risk. So if they're watching that all the time, that's a symptom of it, and it can also be a cause. So I would encourage putting limits on that, how much time they're watching and going online about those things. Couple other things, I mentioned trouble sleeping. Oh, sadness. If they just seem to be kind of sad or low-level depression symptoms, And again, that has to do with, you know, I don't get to see my friends. Seniors in high school didn't get to do all the fun things they were looking forward to. Little kids don't get to go to the playground. If all of that can combine, and if there's an excessive sadness or you sense a depression in that child, that might be an indicator that they are being negatively affected by the pandemic.
Yeah. And I'll add in a couple others that I've come across as I've been talking with some of our families. If you see the way the play has changed, and so for instance, one of our families I was talking with, excuse me, she said that all of a sudden she started playing, her daughter, who's about 6 years old, started playing that her baby doll got COVID. Mm-hmm. And the baby doll died. And the baby doll would keep dying from COVID. Well, that's all truly because that's how she was dealing with it. And it's all from everything that's going on around and talking through mom with that. So if you can see the kids, the way they play, if they're bringing in roles, those are all issues that can raise red flags that you need to be aware of.
Yeah, and the term for that is reenacting the traumatic event. So they're just reenacting it. In an older child, that might show up as talking about it all the time and wanting to just go over all the rules again and again. Almost, you know, it seems like maybe they're obsessive or compulsive. And that can be that kind of an indicator, too. That's a really good one. Yeah.
But, you know, I think, you know, one of the most important things there is that as parents, we need to be observant of what's going on with our kids and be checked in. So let's go ahead and kind of move into the next one then. And that's what actually would put someone at risk of developing post-traumatic stress disorder during an event like this, you know, because not everybody who's exposed to trauma develops PTSD.
That's right.
And so that's one thing I think we need to make sure we delineate and realize, even though our kids are all being exposed to trauma through this, it does not mean they're going to develop PTSD. So what actually raises the risk for the PTSD to actually develop?
Yeah, I would say the main risk factor is the child's previous history of trauma. So if this is your child's really first big life event that they've gone through, that's a negative life event, they haven't had anything else serious, you know, they haven't moved a lot, they weren't in the foster care system, they haven't had a lot of surgeries, they haven't lost significant family members, if they haven't gone through a natural disaster or an accident or anything like that, if none of those things have happened, and this is their first traumatic event, and you are there to guide them through it calmly and to talk over their fears with them and to help them find outlets for their emotions and ways to think positively and to cope, that child's risk of developing PTSD from this is very, very low. So take heart in that. But if the child has a great history of trauma, so starting from a very young age, and the younger they are when they suffered those traumas, the more likely they are to develop PTSD from something like a pandemic, the more pervasive that trauma was. So did it go on for a long period of time? Like my son had 7 surgeries by the time he was 5, and you know, invasive procedures and tests quite frequently during those years too. Sure. So that put him at a higher risk being very young. So if you've got a child that was raised in maybe a foster child or an adopted child who was raised in an abusive home where there was physical, sexual, emotional, or verbal abuse, and it went on a lot, that's going to put them at a higher risk, even if they are now living in a very secure, loving home. If they've experienced a big separation like adoption, even if it happened at birth, they were separated from their birth mother and they don't hear her voice or her rhythms anymore. So that could be a possible red flag. Now, I, I applaud adoption, and I think it's so important, and it's a wonderful gift for families to give. But we have to be aware that, you know, we need to factor that in. They were adopted. I need to be watching carefully during this pandemic to make sure that they're, you know, that this trauma isn't affecting them adversely. So any of those kinds of things, and also something like if they have observed a lot of violence, especially violence toward their primary caregiver, even if the child did not experience the violence, that can be a high risk factor. So is just like observing violence. So maybe a child who's in an area where there's a lot of gangs or, you know, gunfire outside their door for whatever reason, that's going to put them at higher risk. So any of those things are going to make it happen. Another thing I think we really need to key into is that if the parent is dealing with some major mental health issues. Now, I am not talking about maybe a parent who's dealing with some trauma issues or depression issues or even, you know, schizophrenia, and yet they're on medication and they are, everything is well managed and they're doing well. I'm not talking about that. But I am talking about parents who are maybe not receiving treatment for a mental illness and therefore are absent emotionally a lot of the time because they're having to deal with their own issues. So that is a high predictor that a child is going to, that's a high risk factor that could factor into this. And then I think the other thing, we touched on this earlier, is if that child has a lack of role models in their life to show them how to cope with and navigate through a situation like this, that can be a predictor too. So if their role model, again, gets bent out of shape or just can't seem to function, the child has no other person to help teach them that. You know, and one of the things that I'm thinking of in this pandemic is, who are those people in a child's life who have the experience and the wisdom to really talk to them and maybe the time to talk to them about these things and assure them and tell them stories of childhood about, you know, this happened to me and I got through it. Those are grandparents in many, and older people in the kids' lives. And what has happened with this pandemic because of where the high risk, the people at highest risk of death if they contract this virus, are those grandparents. And so all of a sudden these kids aren't in close contact with grandparents. So an easy thing that could be done to rectify that would be to just get on a Zoom call or a FaceTime call with them frequently and have that time together. Even if it's not in person, that could be very comforting for a child.
Yeah. Great points and good things for us to think about. So, thinking then with all that, and we have this trauma here, what can we do then to actually minimize or prevent the trauma that's associated with the pandemic from actually then developing into PTSD? Because it's here. So let's, and we know there's the risk. You've just shared, you know, some of the risk to that we can't do anything about if they already had previous trauma, but what can we do to prevent it from actually moving forward?
Yeah, the first thing we can do is, and I've mentioned this a couple times already, stay calm. Check our own emotions and our own reactions. In fact, there's a really good book called Trauma Proofing Your Kids by Peter Levine and Maggie Klein. And they have what's called the first aid for trauma, first aid for kids who have gone through trauma. And it's like several steps. And step one is, as the person, as the adult, check your own emotional state first and get yourself calm. So then you can go and help the child. So remain calm. If that means you have to go away for a little bit, you know, and scream into a pillow or do something, do that. But get yourself calmed down. And then once you've done that, you're going to be in a better state to provide what kids need. And what they need always, and especially in a time like this where everything seems uncertain, is a secure environment. All of our children need a secure environment, but a child who has gone through previous trauma, has that history of trauma, We know they're more at risk. They especially need that secure environment because their number one need after they've gone through a lot of trauma is to feel safe. And so anything we can do to increase their feeling of safety is what we need to do. So once we provided that secure environment, and you mentioned this a little bit before, we need to create a routine for them because children love routines. They complain about them all the time. But you take away their routines and they just don't know what to do. When I was a teacher, I always thought every fall, the first 2 weeks of the year were setting up routines and showing the kids the expectations. It didn't matter how much spelling we did or math, how many math problems we did. What they needed to know was what I expected of them, what they needed to do when they came into the classroom, how they were supposed to behave and treat one another, when their bathroom breaks were going to be, you know, how you get ready to go out for recess. That's really what they needed. And once they got that in place, and then the other thing I always did was I spent the first 2 weeks making them love me, getting them to love me and buy into me, because once we had a relationship, they would do anything I wanted the rest of the year. And it was the most effective classroom management ever. And so that's what you as parents are doing. You're setting up the new expectations in this new place, and you're assuring them that you love them and they can love you and they can be safe within that relationship. So then another thing I think we can do is we can give our kids a sense of agency. The thing about this pandemic is we don't know where the virus is going to pop up next and who's going to get it and who's not. But we have to make sure our kids know that there are some things we can do to lower that risk. There are a lot of things we can do and be proactive. So we can, like you said, we can learn to wear masks. And so maybe you're going to have to practice wearing masks if your school is requiring them this fall. Start practicing wearing them and talking about why you're wearing them. Really teach them those good hand hygiene habits. We have a 5-year-old and a 2-year-old grandchild who live in our household. And oh boy, we spend a lot of time washing hands. And the 2-year-old is always, she sings, "Happy birthday to me," at the top of her lungs, you know, 2 times through. And we all get those hands washed. But, you know, hand washing is kind of a big fun thing because we all get together and we sing and we do silly stuff and there's lots of bubbles. So if you can make those hygiene habits something fun or... And as kids get older, make them realize, you know, this is what you're doing to help stop the pandemic, to flatten the curve. That's a good thing for them to do. So, and then of course, you know, explaining what it means for social distancing and what we can do and what we can't do. So they realize that there are things they can do, that the world has not ended. We can also provide age-appropriate information about the pandemic. So that means you don't need to tell a 3-year-old, you need to wash your hands or you could die. That is not age appropriate. What's age appropriate is there are some germs that can make people sick. And so we need to wash our hands so that we don't get sick and so the people we love don't get sick. And then you go up, you know, as they get older and tell them what they really need to know. And you can judge that, but too much, we give our kids sometimes way too much information. They don't need to know that, you know, the dark underbelly of everything. They deserve to be kids and have us protect them from that. So do that. Another thing, encourage kids to talk about how they feel. Make sure you take some time to just sit with them and ask them, you know, how's it going? How are you feeling about this? You know, what are you worried about? What are you happy about? What do you wish you could do that you can't do? What can we do instead to kind of make up for that? And then validate their feelings. You know, don't just say, well, you know, when I was a kid, we had this happen and I lived through it and you can live through it too. That's probably not the best thing to do, but say, yeah, you know, I can understand why you're sad. And, you know, I would be sad if I was in your shoes. But here's what we can do instead. I can't change that for you. Here's what I can help you do. And then finally, really avoid us versus them discussions. You know, this whole pandemic has gotten very political, like the wearing of masks, should we or shouldn't we, you know, which political party is what, you know, it's just been kind of crazy. And we need to avoid teaching that mentality to our children. And we need to encourage that we are all in this together. This isn't just about me. It's not just about you. It's about our whole country and what we can do to help everybody in our country get through this. So let's figure out what are loving ways to talk about people, loving ways to speak to people, and loving actions we can take towards them.
Right.
And just model that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll just kind of add on a couple of those points. Those are all fabulous. Especially for our children that have disabilities and special needs. You know, several of the things you talked about, you know, talking about washing hands, talking about, you know, wearing the face mask, and even just talking about COVID, and that there are amazing social stories that are out there on the internet that we can download and do and explain it in such an nice and easy way that helps them understand. And so a lot of times, you know, we think we have to explain everything verbally, but our kids may not learn verbally. So they may need to see it. And that's what the social story is. So especially if you're not familiar with social stories, learn about them. And you can go and Google it. There's a company, I think they're Autism Learners or Little Learners, something like that. I don't remember off the top of my head. I apologize. But I think it's Autism Learners. They've created all kinds of social stories that are free, easy to download, that you can go through, and great resources. But remember that, just like you said, it's having those conversations. It's talking about them. I've had some of those discussions with my daughter, who's neurotypical. But, you know, some of her fears with it, and her biggest, she's not able to see her best friend. You know, it's been 6 months and that. So what do? We immediately call her mom and we set up a Zoom time. And they were on Zoom for 2 hours, and it's just like they're right there with each other.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there's ways you can get around and help alleviate some of this and prevent some of the things that could be causing the trauma.
Right.
Just listening to our kids is an important thing.
That's right. And another thing we can do, we have two grandchildren that live out of state, so we don't get to see them very often, but we do FaceTime with them every month or so. And what I've started doing internet searches of games you can play on FaceTime or on Zoom, you know, virtual games, to give us things to do. And we can help our kids by providing those at whatever their level is, whether cognitively, you know, if they have a developmental delay, find some things that they can do so they can get online and engage with some safe people and their friends and do some of these things, because we're all missing those social interactions.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. So okay, then let's move on to one of our next things, and that's, you know, what then would be some, we're talking about resources, what are some good resources for families as they practice social distancing, or as I prefer to say, physical distancing, because we still need to be social.
That's right.
And that's the thing I want to continue to stress, is through this we must continue to be social. We must continue to be social for our kids. Our kids must be social, but we have to physically distance. So what are some resources we can provide our parents today?
Well, one that is not at all related to special needs, but this is a podcast that my daughter put me onto a couple years ago, and it is called the Lazy Genius Podcast. The Lazy Genius Podcast. And if you just do a search of that, you'll get to it. And she has a website called thelazygeniuscollective.com. And she blogs, she's a mom with three kids, and she blogs and podcasts about how to arrange our lives and set our priorities for what matters. Her tagline is, be a genius about the things that matter and lazy about the things that don't. And
that's
she,
good.
Isn't that good? I'm just like, oh, yeah. I wish I'd done that.
That's
and
gold.
She, Yes, it's golden. And she has a new book. Her first book is just coming out, and I think it's through Worthy Publications, and it's called The Lazy Genius Way. Her name is Kendra Hadachi. So, or Adachi, I think it begins with an A. And everything she tackles, she says, okay, first of all, you have to figure out what matters. So she has several podcasts about the pandemic. So what matters to you about summer during the pandemic with your kids? And then you make your priorities and you go from there. And I would encourage people to just listen to her, because she doesn't tell you how to do it. She gives you a framework to use to figure out how to set your own priorities within your circumstances, which then for us as parents raising kids with special needs is wonderful, because we can apply that to our situation and not feel like, well, yeah, she doesn't have any kids with special needs, she doesn't get it. Well, that's not what it's about. So I would really encourage people to go there. Another resource I think is really helpful, and I just did a podcast episode about this with Jonathan and Sarah McGuire on their Hope Anew podcast.
Yes.
We just recorded it earlier this week, so it'll be a few weeks, I think, before it's up. But we talked about how you can use the 5 love languages, and this is the book Sharing Love Abundantly and Special Needs Families that I wrote with Dr. Gary Chapman, about using the love languages in families affected by disability. And we talked about how you can use them with children who are dealing with trauma, and how they can be a tool to help those kids feel safer, but not a cure. So I would never want you to think that read this book and your child won't have trauma issues anymore. That's not what I'm saying. But it's a good resource to help you help that child feel safe, secure, and loved, so they can keep living and learn to cope with some of their trauma. I think keyministry.org is another great website. They have been, ever since the pandemic started, their blog posts, the majority of them have dealt with pandemic issues specific to special needs families. So I would encourage people to go there. And then just some general resources, go check with your libraries. Your libraries, even though they may not still be open to the public, you may have to do curbside pickup, there are so many resources available through your libraries. I don't know if I mentioned this last time we talked, but Iowa libraries, and I live in Iowa, you can go there and you can check out family passes to zoos, to children's museums, to art parks. We've got a horticultural park called Riemann Gardens that's part of one of the universities that has all sorts of things. You can go there and you can, all sorts of things, ice skating in the winter. You can go there and check out day passes to those events so that you can go to them for free. And I know money is a big issue for families right now during the pandemic. So check with your library. They also have other things. Most libraries are doing virtual story times with kids, virtual craft events where you go and you pick up the craft packet and you take it and you know, tune in at a certain time and they show you how to do it. They have guest speakers for children and for adults. So I would say check with your libraries that they are there for you. And then if you don't know what you're looking for and you just need some help, you can call the lovely librarians and ask them if they know of resources. That's what they're there for. And then along with that, other resources are places like museums. A lot of them are offering virtual tours. So are zoos. Schools can be a good place. If you have a good relationship with a teacher and you've got an issue, I think the teacher would be open to you talking to her, you know, not just like emailing her several times a week, but setting up a time to talk about some issues you have and what they could probably give you some tips. Homeschool sites can often be helpful, especially if your child is going to be going back to virtual school this fall. They might have some good ideas on how to set up your house and, you know, how to arrange your schedule. One resource, I think, especially if you have a medically fragile child, a resource we often overlook are hospital social workers, especially in children's hospitals. My husband is a hospital nurse and he worked in intensive care for many years. So usually before a patient was released, you know, a hospital social worker came in and he watched them connect the patients with all sorts of resources out in the community. And if you need something like that, I would encourage you to call a children's hospital and ask to speak with a social worker there. They may be able to point you to some resources specific to medically fragile children that you aren't aware of. So, and then the same with child life specialists. If you've got a child life specialist in your hospital, you might be able to talk to them and get some information. And then hospitals often, and I would imagine they've moved to virtual format too, they often have educational programs for parents. So those can also be a good resource. And I bet you have some more, well, churches, of course, too. You know, our churches can be a great resource.
Yeah, and I'll go ahead and do a little self-publication thing for us with SOAR. We are going to be opening up and launching here over the next couple of weeks. We will be doing some Zoom interactive classes completely free. They're all virtual, so anyone from across the country can be a part of it. And we're doing it for all age groups. So our preschool kids, we have our first one, we'll have a music therapist coming in for about a half hour where the music therapist will work with them for 30 minutes. They'll be able to be with other, you know, preschoolers their age. And so they'll have some of that social interaction there that they're really not getting a whole lot of. And then have fun with a musical therapist and music and sing and just different things, whatever they can do there. A lot of interaction. For our elementary, and then we'll do one for teens and do one for adults, we're going to do a bunch of different games, karaoke, dance revolution, bingo, scavenger hunts, trivia games, just all kinds of different things that will, and those will all go for an hour long each, where these individuals will be able to have fun, they'll be able to interact with their other friends, make new relationships, but allow them to have a break from just what's going on. And at the other important thing with that is it'll be able to give parents a break with it too. Because so many times our parents who are raising and caretakers and providers for kids with special needs, they are, you know, truly going 24/7 right now. They're not getting any break whatsoever. They haven't been able to get out of the house for 5 months. And so they are desperately needing a break. And so until we can do anything in person, these are going to be some things, and we're going to be, you know, launching those, one of each of those over the next 2 weeks, and we'll continue that moving forward. So if you want more information on that, you can email us here at SOAR at info@soarspecialneeds.org. SOAR, specialneeds.org. But let's then kind of go right on to some of our, the next one then. What would be, you know, talking about strategies for parents, what are some practical strategies that parents can actually implement to help their kids feel safe as this pandemic continues? Because it's not going to end anytime soon.
No.
You know, we've got several months ahead of us, I'm afraid. Most likely the rest of this calendar year.
Oh, I would say so, definitely. You know, they're looking at maybe some vaccines available the beginning of the year, but that's going to take a while to get that out
right
to the public. So even then, I think, you know, we're looking, this is going to have a long tail, let's put it that way. We also already mentioned, we talked about the importance of routine. And I would say, to make that a little more specific, you know, try and come up with a schedule that you, just like you would have a schedule during the school year. The thing about during the school year is your schedule is, you know, get them up and ready to go to school, and then they're there and somebody else deals with their routine, and then I can do other stuff. And then when they get home, we have a routine. But you're just going to have to extend that. So, you know, try not to let everybody sleep in till noon and wear their pajamas all day long. Save that, do it once in a while, but save it so that it's like special, because otherwise Christmas vacation is going to come and there's nothing to look forward to, because you've already spent, you know, you're already used to sleeping in and wearing pajama pants forever. So create a routine where everybody gets up, you know, and they have breakfast and they get changed and dressed for school. There's, I don't know if she's still on, but there used to be this woman called the Fly Lady. And she would always talk about, you know, you have to get up and you have to get dressed in real clothes. And then, you know, she would always tell people, and shine your sink, because, you know, she was all about cleaning stuff. But it's kind of that thing. You've got to figure out and have a purpose. And part of that purpose, you do better if you're dressed and ready to go. Then once you've got that going, break up your day so that there are chore times. So when everybody's working, and then there are some breaks for some activity, including physical activity. And I know, depending on where you live, I'm lucky to be in a rural state, so we can go out for walks. We got a bike path. We have a small acreage, so, you know, our grandkids can get out and really play. But somehow you got to do something, even if that's going to be to find some kind of an exercise routine video on YouTube that you do as a family. So get up and get your bodies moving at different intervals during the day. So you can do schoolwork for a little bit and then get up and do some cleaning so everybody's moving. Then more schoolwork, and then you do your gym class with your routine. And then maybe you go back and finish up schoolwork, and then you have playtime or the rest of your chores and then playtime. My mother was always big at, even in the summer, and she was a school teacher too, we spent the morning working in the summer on what I've considered to be the most stupid menial things that, and I'm sure she just made them up for us to do, but we were cleaning or whatever. And then in the afternoon, we got to play. And that's very wise, because if you play first, there's no motivation to do the work. Very if you true. Have to work before play, then you're going to be motivated to get it done. So work your day out so that there are breaks that are motivating to kids so that they'll get their work done. And then set standards and maintain them. That is so hard, because children are opportunists. You know why they ask you 15 times the same question, can I do this, can I do this, can I do this, can I? The reason they do it is because once, when they ask it on the 20th time, you gave in and said yes. And that's all they need to keep asking, because eventually you're going to give in. So you really have to stick to your guns and maintain your standards, whatever they are. And then at unexpected moments, not related to them asking, just give them grace and say, okay, everybody get up. We're done for today. We're quitting 15 minutes early, and we're going to get out the mini trampoline. We're going to take turns on the trampoline, or we're going to play a game or whatever. So set your routine and then kind of insert some grace in there for them at unexpected moments. I would say, whatever the age of your child, also encourage imaginative play. Imagination is so important. And when we can encourage imaginative play and get our kids to be thinking creatively, we're providing a way for them to escape the pandemic for a while. And don't we all do that? I mean, right. This is why I turn on Parks and Rec, you know, and watch an episode, because to me, it's the funniest show on television ever. And just a half hour of that, I'm like, okay, all right, now I can come back to earth and do it. And that's why I write fiction too, because I get to escape into this world. So whatever that imaginative play is for little children, of course, they'll do it all the time. We have to encourage it more as they get older, but even your middle schoolers and teenagers, you can find ways for them to do imaginative play. It might come in the form of role-playing games, you know, or limited video games that aren't extremely violent. There are some good games out there that they can play. You could encourage them to write creative stories, write their own fiction. That's a great way. But get them using their imagination so that they can kind of escape this world for a while and have fun in another one. Reading to kids, that is hugely important. Set up some time each day to read to your kids, whatever their age level, whatever their disability, they are going to enjoy being read to. That's just something, humans are wired for stories. That's how we learn. That's how we relate. So read to them. And that includes the older kids. We read to our kids for a long time. And what I found really interesting was that when our daughter turned like 12 or 13, she's the one that started reading aloud to us. And especially to my husband, who's not a big reader. And so she read in Pride and Prejudice and all sorts of books he would never have picked up, and he loved them. So, yeah. You know, do that. Or listen to a good audiobook together, too. That's another way to do it. Play board games and card games. There is so much to be learned by that. You learn about taking turns. You learn about enjoying the game instead of who loses and wins. You learn to follow directions. You learn to count depending on the game. You know, you can learn your colors. There's so much easy learning that can be done by playing a game. So get out those board games and play them together, and card games like Uno and Skippo and that kind of thing. Take this time to teach them life skills. Teach them how to do the laundry. Teach them how to, if they're older, teach them how to have a checking account and to keep track of their, you know, withdrawals and where their money goes. Teach them how to cook. Again, you can teach so much math with cooking, and then there's something, there's a reward at the end if you've done it right, something good to eat. Gardening, if you can do that at all, that teaches kids so much about nature, and it gets them out in nature, and then, you know, they're not only learning about how things grow, but about all the bugs that are out there, and the worms, and the sticks, and the, you know, there's just so much there. Let them teach you. Have a time where the kids teach you something. And again, many of our children, we don't give them enough credit, whether they have a developmental disability or they're just very young or they don't communicate well. There are things they can teach us. They might be able to teach us how to draw, whatever their current obsession is. You know, if you have a child who's like obsessed with Pokemon or whatever, or a Disney princess or whoever, they have a whole world they can teach you about, and you can learn it from them. Make cards. Take some time to make cards for people who are in the hospital or in residential care centers, and just send them. That teaches them compassion. That shows them that there are people living with issues they aren't living with. And that's right. Just a good way. The more we can get our kids, especially our kids who are dealing with trauma, to think about somebody other than themselves, and get them out of themselves, that's helpful. It's helpful for us too. Arrange for online get-togethers with family and friends. Our grandson turned 5 at the beginning of the pandemic. Well, it was going on for a few weeks, but early in April. And he was like, the worst thing about my birthday is I don't get to see my aunts and uncles. So we arranged a Zoom call, and they all got on Zoom, and they watched him blow out his candles, and it was wonderful. And just the other day, we had a trivia night with my husband's side of the family, because we didn't get to have our big summer reunion. And the cool thing about that is his family is all over the globe. So we had people from Korea and Russia and all over the United States. And we all got together and had a chance to do something together. Those things can be really good for our kids. So let's do those. And it shows them they are still part of a bigger world. They need that. They need to know they have a support system around them. Finally, if the weather's nice, if you can, get outside. Even if it's just a walk around the block or sitting on your front porch, get outside while you can, because our kids need that. And we all need vitamin D. So
absolutely.
Those are just some ideas that I came up with. You probably have some other great ones too, Doc.
Yeah, no, those are all great. And there are many that we've implemented in our family. And there's many that everyone else can think of too. But let's just kind of jump into, you know, another interesting thought for me is, could you just take a minute or two and talk about how culture of trauma can contribute to PTSD?
Yeah, there's been a lot of research over the years about there are certain cultures, or I don't want to say cultures, that's the wrong word. There are certain environments and certain conditions and situations that create these cultures of trauma. Now, I'm not talking about something like Canada's culture or America's culture. This is something totally different. So these are things, there are certain traumatic environments that children are raised in that can lead to kind of a long-term exposure to trauma that changes the way they view the world. So some of those are a culture of racism. And I think over these last few months, we have seen how that culture of racism that we, who are white privileged, have negatively and unknowingly in some cases used to impact people of different races. So racism can be a culture of trauma. Poverty, you know, if you're always wondering where your next meal is going to come from and if you're going to be able to cover the rent or if you're going to be homeless tomorrow, that is a pressure that's constantly on you. Violent neighborhoods, I mentioned that before. Abusive homes where you never feel safe for whatever reason. War zones are another one. If you're living in the middle of a war zone, that's a culture of trauma. And refugee camps are also considered. So those are some of the major ones. And I would say homelessness would also be another one, which maybe you could group in with poverty, but that's a whole nother level of poverty. And that constant living in that constant situation and kind of that threat, you're always in a threat environment, you never feel safe, makes people more reactionary. And if children, there are studies now that show children that are being raised in those cultures of trauma or that have experienced just a lot of trauma, their brains are different. Different parts of their brains, the thinking parts of their brains are smaller, and that just like the reactionary parts, you know, the instinctual parts of the brain are bigger. And so people think less and react more. That's not, when you think about that, that is not a good way.
It's not a good thing, right?
No. And so the pandemic has the potential of being a culture of trauma. And I think that's the main reason I wanted to touch on that today. And again, that is really, a lot of that is up to us. It does not have to be a culture of trauma, depending on how we as the adults respond to it and navigate our children through it. It can actually be a time of growth, you know, if we use it correctly.
Absolutely. So we're coming up on top of the hour, but you know, one of the important things I want to make sure we can talk about and address here, Air, is what are some effective treatments for children, for teens, for adults, and how can they be accessed during this time of the pandemic?
Well, one of the great things this pandemic has done is it has put a lot more treatment, mental health care treatment, online, so people can access it virtually. And hopefully that will continue after the pandemic is over, because for especially people in rural areas or who have transportation issues, this makes it much more accessible for them. The main thing to do if you're looking for treatment for a child is to realize that it cannot be totally talk-based. These memories are in the nonverbal part. They're stored in the nonverbal part of the brain. And so there have to be techniques to get to those nonverbal memories. And some of those are like hypnosis, play therapy, guided imagery, neurofeedback, eye movement desensitization reprocessing, which is known as EMDR. Family systems is another one. And if you go to my website, differentdream.com, and type in the search bar, how to find a therapist. There are a couple articles that will come up, one for adults and one for children, about how to locate a good therapist for your child in your area. And it has several steps to go through. If you want to know more about some of those treatment options, I recommend the book, The Body Keeps the Score, by Dr. Bessel van der Kolk, I think is his name. And he has been working with children and childhood trauma since the 60s. And he's written a book and he reviews all the different treatments available, the research behind them, their effectiveness, and his personal opinion about them. He's much more knowledgeable about that than me. So it's a slow read, but if you really want to find what's the most comprehensive information available, that's the book to go to. And then if you have any questions, feel free to email me. You can just go to my website, differentdream.com, to the contact me and send me an email and I will answer you.
Yes. Well, fantastic. You know, one of the, as we're closing here, one thing, and I'll allow you here in just a minute to, you know, kind of give your final thought for the day. But one thing I just want to encourage our families and who are listening today, and it's kind of become one of my life words, but it's so important right now during this pandemic. And that word is perspective. And we really need to hold on to that word and really think about that. We need to sometimes change our perspective. You know, so many times when we're in this pandemic or when things are not going the way we want it, we can only focus on all the negative that is happening. And it's a downward spiral. But if we just take a step backwards and change our perspective and actually look for some of the good, oh my gosh, our outlook can change. Yeah. And you know, our mood changes. And all of a sudden, it doesn't seem so bad. It doesn't seem so scary. And you can make it through it. You know, I know for me, there's a lot of positive things that have come out of COVID with it. You know, one is this webinar. The weekly Talk with Doc is strictly a result of having COVID and giving me that little bit of extra time to do that. But oh my gosh, I can't even begin to tell you the number of families with disabilities who, you know, now all of a sudden they're able to attend church services that are online that they never could have before because their child wasn't able to actually get out. And so, you know, there are so many things. But guess what? There are still other things we can remain positive about. We can go outside and see, you know, the beautiful tree, a beautiful sunset, and take advantage of that. Nothing has changed with that with COVID. And we need to celebrate that and focus on that and not about, oh my gosh, I've got to wear my mask. You know what? You just can't forget about the mask. Put it on. It's going to be like, you know, wearing a t-shirt, wearing our underwear. We don't leave without it.
Right.
Well, it's just going to be a part of our clothing and we don't think about it. Change our perspective. Let's find the positive things and let's teach our kids that. And if we can teach our kids how to find the positive things as we move through life, they're going to be so much better. And I really believe, and this is me, I really believe that's going to help protect them from developing any PTSD because it's changing their focus. And you said it earlier, you know, one of the triggers is just when you constantly are dealing with all the negative and just rehashing it all the time. Well, let's stop all of that and let's focus on the positive. So that's my challenge to everyone listening today. Let's change our perspective, find the positive things that are out there. But let me hand it back to you, Jolene. What would you like to challenge our parents or families or listeners or last thoughts for you?
Yeah, and this goes along with you. I was just thinking as we were talking about my mother, who will be 92 next month. And she's in a memory care unit now, but she's still quite cognizant. And she has gone through the Great Depression. She was raised in the Depression. She was a high schooler during World War II. She and my dad were married 10 years. No, they weren't even married that long before he developed multiple sclerosis, and she cared for him in our home until he died. Well, not the whole time in our home, but he died 38 years later. You know, she's gone through, and now she's in a memory care unit. Right now it's closed because they've had a couple cases, and so they're trying to, you know, make sure it doesn't go any further. But you know what? She made it through. And she had a good life, and she would tell you she's had a good life. And her stories, her favorite stories and things she likes best now are to think about growing up with her family during the Depression and during World War II, because those are precious to her. And if she could live through that and think that that was a good life, surely we can make it through this pandemic in the same way. In fact, I would encourage you to go and set up a call with the older people in your life and have them tell some stories to you and your kids about what they experienced and what they have, what they went through and how it changed them, hopefully for the better. So you know, again, have that perspective and start those conversations.
Yeah, that is so good and so true and a great reminder there for it. And again, I'd encourage all of our listeners to use this time to grow your relationship with your family. You know, this is a perfect time to, yes, to, you know, do the fun things that you talked about, the board games, doing puzzles, whatever it might be, family time that we've always been too busy to do before. We don't have those excuses now, so let's take advantage of it. But Jolene, thank you so much for joining us today. I want to encourage everyone to join us next week. We're going to have another very important talk another great speaker is going to be coming in, and that is Melanie Gomez. And we are going to be talking on transitioning into adulthood and everything you need to know about as a parent in preparing your teen for adulthood. What do you need to know to do it successful, to prepare things, what are out there? So it's going to be a very important talk. I encourage you to be back and join us for that. Melanie's written a book as well, and great author, and she will, just like Jolene, and Melanie will also be a speaker at our Wonderfully Made conference coming up in October, and we'll have registration coming up for that this next week. But again, thank you everyone for joining. We'd love to have you continue to partner with us. If you'd love to partner with us financially, encourage you to go to soarspecialneeds.org/donate, and you can help with us in being able to continue doing these webinars with that. But Jolene, again, thank you so much for today. A lot of great information, and just hope our families can apply it and realize, you said it, we're going to get through this. This is temporary. It's not going to be a lifelong thing. It's for just the moment.